Welcome back to Light the Fuse, your one-stop shop for all things Mission Impossible and all things Top Gun. We got a little Light the Fuselage in here, too. You know what I mean? So
we are lighting the fuselage for the first time.
First time.
Whew. Yes. But not yet.
Not yet. Feels good.
We got a lot to talk about. We did our trip.
Right.
I feel like we're getting better at this.
Yes.
Last year, we went to Vegas for CinemaCon, and it was a pretty crazy trip. I think we made it there and back. In under 24 hours.
Yes, correct.
Driving.
Yeah.
This time we planned ahead a little bit more. We're a little bit more familiar with Caesar's Palace.
Yes, yes.
Not too much more familiar.
Not too much more familiar.
That place is gigantic.
It's huge. It's absolutely huge. But we made it work. I think we had a great time. I'm speaking for myself, but I think we did a good job.
I'm in agreement. I think we did it. I think there's a lot to talk about.
It's a lot to talk about. But
a lot to digest.
Let me just put a pin in that for 1 second.
Okay.
I'm going to do my favorite part of the show. Obviously, my shout-outs. This episode is brought to you by John B., also Elvis Ripley, whose Mission Impossible has influenced his career. And instead of thanking Jeremy Dillon, he wants us to all listen to a song for an artist that he manages. Her name is Imogen Clark. The song is called Enemy. It's out now. It's on SoundCloud. I'm sure it's on Spotify and Apple Music. And he just wants to encourage people to check her out, listen to the song. And he wants me to tell you, Charles, that her favorite Mission Impossible film is Mission Impossible Rogue Nation. He doesn't have her complete rankings, but I thought that was...
So we should get those.
Yeah, we got to get them. We're still waiting for Casey Musgraves. But yeah.
So say again, what is her name and what's the name of the song?
Her name is Imogen Clark. The song is called Enemy. Okay. It's out now.
So people should check it out.
Check it out.
We love Jeremy Dillon. We'd do anything for him.
Yeah.
There's that. So
let's get into it.
Let's talk about this. Yeah. So we went to CinemaCon. We're there for the Paramount panel.
Yes.
They had a whole rap dance for Sonic the Hedgehog 2.
Yeah, a lot of patting themselves on the back for the success of Sonic the Hedgehog 2. Some awkward dancing. I thought it was maybe a rap parody. Charles thinks it was just a real genuine corporate-sponsored rap about Sonic the Hedgehog. So if there's video out there of this, you'd let us know what you think. If it was sincere or
yes,
more topical, but... then we got a sizzle of all things. See, this is
where the fake out happened.
This is the fake out. They showed scenes from, well, they showed a logo for the new Scream that's coming out next year. They showed footage from Babylon and a couple of other things. Okay, but
they showed footage from Transformers. There was an Optimus Prime in the rain.
There was
that
a
looked
cool,
pretty cool.
And there was a cool chase on a mountainside with a Transformer.
Yes, yeah, it was a female Transformer.
Yes.
I think it was from the, she was in some of the old series, but she was in the original animated movie, too.
Okay.
It was like a pink female character, right?
Like a VW bus or something.
Yeah,
it was very cool.
It was very cool looking. Like the edge of a cliff, like a highway that's on the edge of a cliff.
Yeah.
It was very
cool.
And
a little
looking.
Bit, you reminded me some stuff from, what is it called? Dungeons and Dragons?
Yes, which Chris Pine is going to be
Chris
in.
Chris Pine is
right?
in, yeah. And so it was good. I thought it was a very impressive sizzle. I mean, they've
yes.
had a really great year, and they've got a lot of fun things coming up.
And they threw in there... They were showing their titles
title
of what's coming in 2023, and one of them was Mission Impossible 7.
Yeah.
That's how it showed up on the screen, and it was in the original 1996 movie font.
Yes.
Kind of the red font with the, like, kind of missing line across.
No subtitle.
No.
No, nothing. Okay, so...
Is that it?
Maybe that's it. Okay, so cut to... Well, first of all, last year, they did this whole bit where they were in a car. They were about to shoot a car chase.
Yes, it was
Tom Cruise
driving.
In a car. And then who comes up in another car? Oh, it's Christopher McQuarrie, our friend. And he says, hey, Tom, we got to start shooting. And they drive off. Okay, so that was last year.
And that was how they introduced
the
sizzle reel
yes.
from last year. For
so how are they going to top it?
How do you top that?
How do you top that? We know they're still shooting. That has not changed in the last 8 months.
Yeah.
What are they going to do? What do you think, Charles?
Well, one way to do it is to have Tom Cruise on a... Was he on a red biplane or was he on the yellow one?
He was... I don't know which one he was on.
He was... So it's a beautiful biplane.
Restored, yeah.
You can tell from the start he's flying because it's like a close-up of his face and he's talking to camera and he's talking about how they're shooting right now. And they're up, very high in the sky.
Yes.
Flying, and he's on top of this plane looking back at camera, talking to camera.
Yes.
And then a second biplane comes up, and it's Christopher McQuarrie, and it's kind of the similar
I think
bit.
It's the same dialogue, where he's like, we gotta shoot. No, we really gotta shoot. And then Christopher McQuarrie says something about it. They're running low on gas, and Tom's like, oh, wow, we don't want to run on fumes. But then the camera pulls back, and they kind of do a roll, and it's very cool and impressive. Sort of synchronized together.
And McQuarrie was inside the second plane, right?
Yes.
He was, like, in the cockpit of it, like,
he was
in
not,
the second seat of, of that plane. Cruise was, like, standing on top of his plane, right?
Just casual.
Yeah.
He looked great. His hair looked great.
Which, yeah, we, you know, we noticed there was a there was like a video introduction he did for some festival or something that Top Gun Maverick is playing.
Right.
And we saw a video of this a few days ago, and the video got pulled before we could look at it and dissect it more.
Right.
But his hair is longer.
Yeah.
Than it was in the clips you see for 7. So in 8, his hair is going to be longer?
I mean, we've theorized there is a time jump, perhaps.
Maybe
so,
there's
yeah.
a time jump. That's the only thing that could account for his hair being so different.
Yeah.
Also, would like to, I like seeing the hair going longer.
Yeah.
The, it goes, it's long enough to dip over the ears.
Yeah, some people, I think, when they get older, their ears get bigger, and they get kind of self-conscious about that.
Oh.
Yeah.
Is that a problem for you?
Well, my ears are out and proud right now, so maybe that will change in the future.
I don't think Cruise has any problem with his ears.
No, I think he's a perfect specimen. But, so then, we get it. Full-on trailer.
Yeah.
Cut.
It has the green
logo. MPA.
The MPA. You know, all approved for all audiences. This is an official trailer that we assume will play with Top Gun Maverick when it hits theaters.
Yes, I think that is true.
That's an add-up. Maybe it'll go online before that.
Yes.
You think it's possible
think
in the week
is...
leading up to it, maybe?
Yeah.
So this might be out. I mean, it's possible it could even come out next week.
Yeah, I think the timing works, yeah.
It could be that. Or, or it could be the week leading up to the release of Top Gun Maverick.
I think it's usually about 2 weeks before it goes out. So
right.
We got Thor last week, and it'll go out with Strange, which opens next week. So 2-3 weeks, it could be next week. You're right. So anyway.
Right. So anyway, this trailer is, I think, last year was very much a sizzle reel.
Yes.
This year, it is a trailer that is for public consumption, that you will get to see this soon.
Yes.
And what is there to say? It is mind-blowing. It starts slow, mysterious.
We get narration.
You get narration from a voice that you and I immediately recognize.
Yes, I would say it's not narration. It's voice over.
Yeah, it's pre-lap dialogue.
Yes,
is what it is. You get to see who it is eventually who's talking.
Yeah,
and that is the one and only Kittredge.
Yes,
who's back from the first movie, and he's talking to someone. It's a little bit mysterious.
Yeah, what's nice is that as that narration kind of comes to an end, it kind of goes through different characters. So we see Ving. We see, you know, Simon Pegg, we see the White Widow.
Right.
Hello.
And it's who is he talking to? He's talking to somebody, and he's sort of telling them that, you know, there are two sides, you got to pick a side.
Right.
It's kind of what it's sort of that was the gist of the dialogue.
Yeah, something
right?
is coming.
And you got to
figure it out.
You
got
to figure out which side you want to be on. We assume probably talking to Ethan.
Yep. Because that's the last person you see.
Yeah.
He looks up. Ethan's making a decision. He doesn't say anything, but.
Yes.
Then all hell breaks loose. I mean, there is so much. We will do a full forensic analysis when we can watch it over
and
over
when
again.
We can get the trailer and we will do a full episode about that, or at least a Patreon episode, really dissecting every frame.
Yeah.
But, I mean, there are so many things to talk about. We just have to just, I think, throw them out. Just things that you remember.
This is not in order.
No, this is just things that we saw.
Yeah.
I think the trailer starts with some imagery in the desert.
Yeah, there's a really striking shot of a bunch of guys in sort of military gear coming through an archway in the desert. And what's so cool about it is they all come in, and then we assume Ethan comes in and the camera kind of tracks with him back.
Oh, yeah.
That was very
cool. I didn't think that was Ethan. You think that was Ethan? I thought it was some kind of team. Maybe it was, though. It happened so fast.
It was so cool.
That it's hard to keep up with every image that goes by.
Yes.
But there's desert vistas. There's, you know, Ethan on horseback. There's Ilsa with a sniper gun in the desert.
And an eye patch.
Yeah, an eye patch, which we've heard people have said online, snipers use an eye patch to help with the long-range aiming or whatever. So we assume that's why Ilsa has an eye patch, but you never know.
Submarine confirmed.
Yes, there was a submarine.
Yes.
We did see, someone asked on Twitter, because we mentioned submarines, was it more than one submarine? I kind of think I only saw one submarine.
I think there was only one.
It was one shot.
Yes.
And that was it. We didn't get anything else. There was nothing. It was just an exterior it was underwater shot of a submarine.
It seems to me that there will be something where someone will impersonate Carrie Elways. I think there's a shot with two Elwayses.
Oh, I didn't catch that.
Yeah.
Wow.
Tell me if I'm wrong. When this comes out, you guys can yell at me.
We'll see. There's a close-up magic.
It's close-up magic.
Tom Cruise does a thing where he like suddenly has a key in his hand or some kind of object.
It looks like a USB drive.
Yeah, maybe like a fancy USB drive. He makes it suddenly appear in his hand, right in front of you.
Yeah,
it's right in the camera.
And there's another shot with Ilsa with that on, like around her neck.
Yes.
So we missed that, the MacGuffin, or part of the MacGuffin.
Yeah.
We will see.
And there was a shot of Ilsa kind of hanging from, I don't know, from a helicopter or something. It was a close-up, so you couldn't quite see. Mm-hmm. But it's like looking down at her, or she's looking up at Ethan, and Ethan's holding on to her.
Yes.
And it looks dangerous.
Yes. There's a lot of cool outfits. There's a scene with Carrie Elwes, or, in my estimation, the Carrie Elwes doppelganger.
Okay.
Wearing some really cool looking gas mask. Very designed. And all these gas explosions are going off, which we have confirmed are the work of our friends at Industrial Light and Magic, which is very cool. Sort of green.
It's a green kind of gas explosion that looks really cool.
And there's another scene underwater. So this is happening with a kind of like almost steampunky scuba suit.
Yes.
And we do not know what that is about either.
Is it Scuba Luther?
Pray to God. I mean, we can confirm we saw the team is back. We've got Peg and Ilsa and Ving Rhames.
Yes.
Everybody is here. White Widow,
mm-hmm.
Kittredge. It just looks...
I feel like there was a little bit of overlap of what we saw last year.
Yes.
But there was a lot of new stuff.
Yeah, there's a shot locked onto the train as it's going off the bridge. Yes. That is insane.
And also a wide of the train going down too.
And then you get some of the big stunt, which we saw a whole featurette about last year. That was the main focus.
The big motorcycle stunt kind of ends the trailer.
Yeah.
But there's also a lot of the driving around the streets of, is it Rome?
Yeah, we see
in the yellow car.
Yeah.
It looks like Cruise is driving with one hand because he's handcuffed to Haley Atwell or something. Like, it looks like he's really, you know, having to drive that car in a difficult Fiat way.
And Palm is after them in a big truck. And we also see the beginning of Palm
driving like a Hummer or something?
Something armored. Yeah. She's bashing into cars and they're going flying in.
Oh my God. The car stuff looks fucking incredible. Yeah, it looks
insane. A lot
insane.
Of amazing angles.
And I think another big thing we should talk about too is the cinematography. We
Frasier.
People have talked about the, you know...
Worried.
Ben David Grabinski we just had on the show. And he was talking about, oh, you know, we're going digital now. Is that going to be an issue? It looks like film to me. I mean, from what we saw, we're a little further back in the theater, but everything to me just looked incredibly filmic. Also, you know, we'll get to Top Gun Maverick later, but that movie also looks incredibly filmic.
Yeah. Also looks like some angles and places you can put a camera that maybe you couldn't lug a
film camera, no.
Also, we got to talk about this, Charles. Sword fight. Isai versus Ilsa. How are we feeling about that?
Ilsa is wielding a sword.
Yeah.
On a bridge in, it looks like, Venice.
Yes.
And is about to have a showdown with Isai Morales where they're going to have some kind of sword match or something. That's pretty... It looks fucking awesome.
Yeah. He seems to be really giving Cruise the business in this movie. We see him on the train, too.
Yes, there's a little bit
he's
of...
He's climbing. And also them reaching for a knife on top of a train, which is very reminiscent of the first movie's tunnel chase.
Yeah, they're like in some kind of tunnel fighting on top of the train. And there's also in the broad daylight, also on top of the train, like, you know, fisticuffs. It looks so fucking amazing.
Yeah.
You'll see it looks epic. Someone was asking us, like, comparing, you know, what is this trailer? They were asking on Twitter, you know, compared, you know, zero, on the scale of zero to Fallout, how is the trailer? Because, you know, Fallout, we've talked about, that's another thing we talked to Ben David about, is how amazing that Fallout trailer is.
Yes.
And I think, you know, we talked about it. This is more of a teaser.
Yeah.
There's really nothing about plot in this at all. We have no...
But we should say some new Lauren Balfe music that is beautiful and very ominous.
Oh, man.
Which, speaking of ominous, let's get to that title.
Okay. They have announced the title now officially. It is Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 1.
Which means next year...
We'll get Dead Reckoning Part 2.
Well, year after Dead Reckoning Part 2.
But let's talk about it. We actually haven't even spoken about this. Yeah. What do you think of the title?
I'm very into it.
Yeah.
It's going to eat up a lot of characters on Twitter, so don't be surprised if we keep using that MI78. But I think it's great. I mean, we've heard, you know, the swashbuckling Mission Impossible. We've seen all this stuff, you know, as we said, this submarine and sword fights and underwater scuba gear.
Yeah.
It feels like an adventure.
It's
an adventure. It's a kind of a film noir-y. I think Humphrey Bogart was in a movie called Dead Reckoning 100 years ago. So I like it a lot. How do you feel about it?
Yeah, I think it's a great title.
Yeah.
I think on Twitter there was a little bit of back and forth. Some people were saying they weren't happy with it, but I don't know if they were real Mission fans. It was just on one Twitter thread I saw.
It beats Shadow War, which is the rumored title.
Yes. No, that's not nearly as good. I think Dead Reckoning sounds like, I don't know, I hope it's not the hope it's not our finale of the whole series, but if it is, sounds like a good title.
Makes sense. Yeah.
Dead Reckoning.
All right. You ready?
Are we? Wait.
Let's put our sunglasses on.
Wait. Are we already doing this?
I think we are.
Is there nothing else about Mission?
Well, I want to wait because I really want to do a deep dive. I don't want to say anything. I don't want to speak out of turn.
Okay.
I thought the logo was very cool. If they end up using
yes, that throughout. The title treatment for Mission Impossible: Dead Reckoning. We don't know who did it. We can only assume and hope that it was our friends at Filmograph. Because it looks like their work. And
yeah.
To me, it's that amazing. It had a little bit of a Fallout vibe, but it was new. Actually, the font was also a little bit Rogue Nation-y. It was somewhere in between. I don't know. It happened so fast, it's hard to even remember exactly what it looked like.
We're like, oh, that's the name. What's interesting is it stayed on Mission Impossible for a long time. It was like, oh, are they going to go like the Scream route? This is just going to be Mission Impossible? But then
Dead Reckoning came up over on top of it.
And then underneath. Smaller,
and then part one.
So, wow. Yeah. We will be back. I think we should devote a whole show. We'll do a shot-by-shot breakdown.
But what I was going to say about the Fallout show, so to me, this somehow looks more epic than Fallout.
Yes. It just looks like nonstop.
Yeah.
Because we saw, 2 seconds of a sequence that I'm sure will go on for 15 minutes.
Right.
McQuarrie has talked about how these movies are 25-minute set pieces. And
right.
So just a hint of this. I mean, the whole trailer is probably 2 minutes, I would say.
Maybe, yeah. Okay.
So and not a lot of time to maybe really only, dig maybe, into
might,
things.
It might even be 90 seconds.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, it's... Whew, you got.
But it's a lot.
It looks fucking epic.
Yeah.
And incredible.
Yeah, it's going to be great.
Cannot wait.
All right, put your aviator glasses on.
All right, let's do it. Ready? We're going to start Light the Fuselage.
All right, Luke, play the music. Okay, here it comes.
So we're going to keep this spoiler-free.
We're in it.
All right.
All right. We're here. Welcome.
This is it. Welcome to Light the Fuselage.
This might be the only episode. We'll see how we go in the next couple weeks. But yeah.
We saw Top Gun Maverick.
First audience to see it.
What to say? We talked a lot about in the car.
Yes.
This movie, I think, is... There are sequels. I think Fallout is one of these sequels. There are rare sequels that actually make the previous movies better.
Yeah.
This one makes the original one better.
I agree. And I think the first movie is kind of perfect, which is saying something.
Yes. But this movie, and you were talking, you had some interesting things about it to say that the movie is sort of, this might sound misleading, but it's sort of a character study of Maverick in some ways, in a subtle way, I think.
It's a very interesting look at where he is.
Yes.
It might surprise you where Maverick is and the relationships he has with people. And I just thought it was fascinating. I thought it was really wonderful. And I know people are like bemoaning the fact that Cruise hasn't done a Magnolia type movie. But to me, this was as rich as anything he's done before.
Yes.
It is brilliant. And he doesn't have a lot of character traits in the first one that you could see. Oh, well, maybe they elaborate on this or whatever. I mean, this is like just... We'll take your breath away, pun intended. It's just great.
And I want to keep it spoiler free. We want to keep it spoiler free.
Yeah.
We'll do a spoilerific episode
later.
When the movie comes out. We'll talk about our 5 favorite parts. But it's really remarkable what they've done with this movie. I watched the first one recently. I think that's a question. I think there's a question for you. Do you think people need to watch the original? I don't think they need to watch the original again. Yeah. Just watch this. But I would recommend it.
Yeah.
I would actually recommend 3 movies to watch before this.
Okay, go ahead.
I would recommend you watch the original, Top Gun.
Okay.
I would recommend you watch the documentary, Val, Yes. The Val Kilmer. It's all about Val Kilmer, and it was made by Val Kilmer, or was it?
There were two documentarians, but he was obviously very hands on.
Yes, and it's made largely of his footage from and pictures of his life.
I loved that movie.
He filmed a lot of his life over the years while he was making all these different movies, and you see where he is in his life now, and it's. I think seeing that movie will add to the power of this movie. At least it did
without
for
saying
me.
Anything. We're yes. not saying anything. Yeah.
And the third movie, I would say this is more ancillary, but I would say Only the Brave, because I think Joseph Kaczynski and Miles Teller are doing some of the best work that they've done, and they re-team on this movie, Top Gun Maverick.
Yes.
And they did Only the Brave together, and it's a very amazing, underrated movie that nobody saw. So I wanted to throw that in there. Those are three titles I would recommend. None of them are necessary.
No.
To see Top Gun Maverick. But that's my two cents.
Yeah. We talked about how Jennifer Connelly does play a character mentioned in the first movie.
Yes.
And I will say this.
Which is not really a spoiler, because if you didn't know that, you wouldn't. They don't ever say it in the movie. Obviously they can't reference and say, hey, you came up in the first movie.
Right.
But they just mention the name Penny in the first movie.
Yeah. An admiral's daughter.
And then they just take that seed and they run with it for this movie.
And it's very touching, I felt.
Yes. That relationship totally works.
Yes. We're not going to say anything about it.
No.
But that totally works. How they interact or anything, but it's amazing. I just think that what Kaczynski and McQuarrie and his co-writers and Eddie Hamilton, this movie is edited so beautifully.
Yeah.
They just achieved something miraculous. It's really a joy.
It hits on all cylinders.
Yes.
The comedy works. It's hilarious.
Yeah.
The emotions land. I mean, I cried so many times.
Yeah. Yeah.
We'll talk another time about when those moments were happening.
Yeah.
But there were multiple times where I was crying.
Yes.
And then also just thrilling, unbelievably thrilling. The dogfighting sequences and everything are out of this world. My heart was racing.
Yeah.
After one of those big sequences, that big action sequences, I felt my heart and realized, oh my God, I'm still like trying to calm down from that.
Yeah. I want to say too that there's some good surprises. So maybe the less you know, we're going to keep it spoiler free, but the less you know, the better.
Okay. I'm not sure what that refers to, but yes.
Well, there's the movie takes some, it zigs sometimes when you think it's going to zag. And,
yes.
And it's all the more rewarding.
And it just delivers. It delivers every step of the way, for sure.
And let's talk about the cast.
Oh, man. Yeah, I mean, everybody is great. Obviously, Cruise is the number one. I guess I would say Miles Teller is the second lead.
Yeah.
And he's fucking great. Perfect in his role. Jennifer Connelly, totally, like we said before, their relationship totally works. John Hamm, we were talking about him in the car on the way back. It's like you said, it's a little bit of a thankless role, and he just delivers brings it.
He eats it up. He has and he has a side of dressing with it, and he just makes it happen. And he's amazing. He brings just the right amount of gravitas, but also leniency in terms of like letting some of this happened. He actually plays a cadet that graduated 2 years after Tom.
But don't say anything more.
We won't say anything more.
Yeah.
He is a graduate of the Top Gun cadet who's now running it. Okay. Is that?
Yeah, sort of. I guess that's what he's doing. Yeah.
That's what he's doing, Charles.
Okay.
But let's talk about the kids.
Glenn Powell. Great. We love. He's so great, and everybody wants him. The Richard Linklater baseball movie.
And Apollo 10 and a Half right now.
And Apollo 10 and a Half, another Richard Linklater movie that's on Netflix now, which is also wonderful, and people should watch. Glenn Powell is so good in his role.
He is good. He's, without giving anything away, we'll say he is the Iceman surrogate to this group.
Sort of.
Okay. But superficially.
Yeah, superficially. Okay. That's good.
That's all I'll say. Lewis Pullman,
hilarious.
Hilarious. We won't say anything about him or his call sign because it's just too good.
But is he Bill Pullman's son?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Started with John Hamm in Bad Times at the Opera.
Well, just so you know who we're talking about, Lewis Pullman plays Bob.
He plays Bob. I wasn't going to give that away, but you just did.
His name is Bob.
His name is Bob. We loved
Ed Harris is in a small role.
Small role. Monica Barbaro, who plays Phoenix. Great.
She's great. Small, kind of a smaller part of the group, but just really makes
keeps everybody in line.
Yeah, and really, really lands every moment that she has.
And Danny Ramirez is Fanboy, another somewhat important trainee.
Yeah.
And Jay Ellis is Payback. I mean, They're great. Everybody is. And you know who I really love? I loved Charles Parnell, who plays Warlock, who is another, who's sort of Ham's second in command.
Yes.
But you can tell
he has some great moments with Cruise.
Yeah, they've had a history there. Yeah. Yes. And it is just wonderful.
And Greg Tarzan Davis as Coyote is part of the group.
Who we saw twice that day.
He's also in the Mission Impossible 7 trailer.
Yes, we saw him with Shea Whigham looking at a map or something. Something on a car. Yeah, anyway. I'm
curious to see what a role he has in the Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 1. Now that we have a title.
Rolls off the tongue. Woo! Yeah. But yeah, it's just a fantastic cast. Everybody brings their A game. And everybody has a moment. I love that.
Yes. Everybody gets their time in the sun, and they all deliver. This is something that we were talking about, too. Without any spoilers, I'll say, like, the movie has these incredible homages to the original that always feel totally organic to this story.
Yes.
They're never shoehorned just to give you a fan service moment. They all, like... And it, honestly, again, they would pass by and they fit seamlessly within the movie. And if you don't remember the first movie at all, it wouldn't even matter. And if you do remember the first movie, you're like, oh, this is kind of that similar scene and that's similar to the first one. But it doesn't feel like cheap. It doesn't feel unearned.
It's not a parade of empty nostalgia.
No.
Which some could claim other movies of this ilk have done. But
and it does that, like you said, that it's an exploration of the Maverick character in this different time in his life.
Yeah.
And it's really beautiful.
It's beautiful, and I think the archetypes are almost mythic in their nature, but also very much intimate and scaled down. And there's a big theme here, as we've talked about Turning Red and a couple of other things, about intergenerational trauma, what that means. Obviously, everyone knows that Miles Teller is Goose's son.
Yes.
There's a lot to unpack.
That's in the trailer.
That's in the trailer. So there's a lot to unpack. It does not unfold as, again, superficially as it does in the trailer. There's a lot of stuff there, and it's amazing, and I don't think we can really talk about it, but we can talk about who's on the soundtrack. None other than Stephanie Germain, whatever her last name is, Lady Gaga. Lady Gaga.
Yes, and she has a music credit, music by credit. That was like the music, the credit is music by Harold Faltermeyer, Lady Gaga, and Hans Zimmer.
Yes.
And then score produced by Lauren Balfe.
All our favorite people.
Some heavy hitters there.
Yeah.
And Lady Gaga's song that is in it, Hold My Hand, plays at the end of the movie. I hope that's not too much of a spoiler. I mean, it's kind of...
No, like, I said that.
It's what you expect. And her the melody of that song it is incorporated in the score.
Yes.
And that's where that music by credit comes from for Lady Gaga.
And it's great. I think the song was great. I think the melody is great. The score is great.
You had said it would have been nice to have a little bit more of the 80s synth sound maybe in the movie, but you know, it's a modern movie. It never goes with the empty nostalgia.
It doesn't go
into like 80s songs just for the sake of 80s songs or anything. It has a blend of some older songs and some newer songs. And
everything has an emotional weight.
It's true. Even like that, like when they do homages to the original movie, it's not empty. It's actually like used in a new way, in an emotional way that really rings true.
And a plot way too. This movie is wonderfully plotted. I mean... There is no fat at all.
No. And the third act is mind-blowing.
Yes.
Fucking mind-blowing.
Yes.
I'm gripping my seat, and it is just jaw-dropping, incredible. The way it's staged and everything about it is just incredible. But I wanted to say this, too, about Joseph Kosinski's direction. It's easy to jump to the aerial insane scenes, but I said this to you already after we saw it. The scene that struck me so much in terms of his direction and his staging, it's actually this is not a spoiler, but it's just there's the first bar scene when Tom Cruise and you kind of get introduced to all the characters.
Yes.
Watch the staging in that scene.
Yes.
Because that is not easy. They're very clearly laying out all the characters, and they're doing so many different eye lines.
And
Tom Cruise is watching all these different people. Group scenes are very hard to direct and to get all the eye lines right. And Joseph Kosinski, who I think is a Fincher
he's an acolyte. He's a protege.
And there's definitely like an obsessive, perfect approach to making sure that there's nothing disorienting about that scene. And that's testament not only to Kaczynski's direction, but also Claudio Miranda's cinematography and, of course, Eddie Hamilton's editing. Because a lot happens in that scene, and it happens fast, and you never get disoriented.
Yes, and you retain it going forward. Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's a surprise that the action sequences are beautifully directed. If you've seen Tron or Oblivion or Only the Brave, he can clearly handle that. But to bring that level of precision and kind of mathematic staging to sequences that are purely emotional or character driven, huge achievement.
Yeah.
We love Kaczynski already. We love him even more now.
Yeah.
And
that, I mean, is this his best movie?
Probably.
Yeah.
And, it's,
and you had said something earlier today about legacy sequels. Where does this place amongst legacy sequels, meaning Mad Max Fury Road? Although it's a little bit, is it a legacy sequel?
I think it is. Yeah, I think Mad Max Fury Road, Terminator Dark Fate, Force Awakens,
the new Halloween
with
Jamie Lee Curtis,
Ghostbusters,
the new Scream movie.
Yeah.
The new Ghostbusters is we were comparing those two movies quite a bit at one point.
Yeah.
Because that movie, I don't want to gang up on it too much, but in some ways rings hollow.
It fetishizes a movie that didn't take itself seriously in the first place, but now, 35 years later, every knob is lovingly, you know, photographed.
Right.
This is the opposite because it's sort of like the kind of, I don't know, exterior trappings don't really matter, but it's about the heart and the characters and where they are now, and it's beautiful.
And that tone matches the original.
The tone matches the original, but it is an evolution. It is much more progressively cast. It is much more progressively kind of depicted in terms of the power dynamics of the relationship, and it's a very 2022 movie. I know they shot it 2 or 3 years ago, but it feels very modern and...
Yeah. You can see how they were fine with waiting on this movie.
Yeah.
You could drop this movie at any point.
It's timeless.
And, I mean, there's some texting, I guess, in the movie. Spoiler. Which is like...
But texting has been around for a while, and it'll be here to stay.
It'll probably be here for a while.
Yeah.
But it's pretty timeless.
Yeah.
It's pretty timeless.
I think it's maybe the best. For discounting Mad Max, totally the best.
Yes, totally the best. Mad Max Fury Road, I just revisited recently, and it is... a fucking masterpiece, and I need some time to process where, but this right now I would say is like pretty even with Mad Max Fury Road.
Yeah.
To even think that it could be comparable to Mad Max Fury Road is quite an achievement.
I like this one, I think, because it's funnier than Mad Max Fury Road.
Yes, okay. I mean, it's they're different movies.
They're very different movies. They are insane technical achievements.
Yes, and the scale of the action is like stuff you've never seen before. So in some ways. You can compare them.
Yeah. I was just incredibly impressed all the way around.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, is there anything that was a drawback to you or that felt like it was... I mean, I think I talked a little bit about this. I felt like maybe there were a couple times in the first act where I was a little worried, like, oh, is this taking a little too long? There's a lot of setup. But it's like, in our interview with McCory, our first interview, he talked about you don't want to have exposition in your action sequences.
Right.
He's like, and it's like having broccoli baked in your brownies.
Right.
And he's like, what you want to do is you want to eat your broccoli and then have your brownies afterwards. Don't put broccoli in my brownies.
Yeah.
And to me, that was like, you get the broccoli at the beginning and then you get fucking brownies.
Yeah. For a good 2 hours. It's an hour and 31 minutes, flies by, pun intended, on that one, too.
Wait, how long is it?
131.
130, so, okay, just over 2 hours.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it flew by.
No post-credit sequence, we should say that. We stuck around.
Yes, there was no post-credit sequence.
We will be back to talk about this, obviously.
There's more to talk about. I think next week we're actually going to be going back into Light the Fuse.
Yes.
But we will be back to Light the Fuselage again.
Yes.
Don't you worry. There
yes.
will be at least one more, maybe more, hopefully more than that.
I hope so.
Of Light the Fuselage.
We're working on it. You know what I was thinking while I was watching it? I said we could do, to myself, 200 episodes just about this movie.
You could.
You
it's
could?
So epic.
Yeah.
And there's so much.
There's so many people that worked on it.
I would love to talk to some of the people who worked on this movie. Man, it is an achievement.
Yeah. It's really.
And you can
really
see
wonderful.
Why Paramount really was sitting on this and waiting for the right time.
Yeah. I would not want to see this. At home.
No, and I cannot fucking wait to see it on IMAX.
Yeah.
We saw it at they converted the Colosseum inside of Caesar's Palace.
Yeah, I think it's...
They added Dolby Vision and Dolby Sound. They made it into a screening theater for us. and it was fucking awesome.
It was just presentation for us. They said this was going to be just shitty THX, but since you two are here, it's going up to Dolby.
It looked and sounded outstanding, yes. And people were cheering. People were, you could hear sniffles.
Oh my God. People were sobbing through the entire movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's all we'll say. But also, I do think that some of that crying was just being so overwhelmed.
Yes. There's different, we'll get into it when we can talk about the movie, but there are many different moments in the movie where I cried for very different reasons.
Yes.
And it's a beautiful movie.
It's a beautiful, it's just pure joy.
Yeah.
The world
needs this.
The world needs it. I don't know if it even deserves it. It's that good. And yeah. We are going to talk about it all summer, I'm sure.
Yes. So. It was a pleasure to be in the same room as you. We got to go on this adventure.
Yes.
Everything's over Zoom, and now we get to have a friendly, fun time.
Yeah, it was great.
So I've got to say a special thank you to Ben Wright for making this episode possible.
Wish he was there with us.
And I also got to thank Luke Burson, our editor and mixer, and also Kevin Blumenfeld for his music, and also, I guess, Harold Faltermeyer for the original the original Top Gun theme, which we're just going to use brazenly. And,
come and get us!
Come after us, Paramount. Yeah. I guess we're getting some skin in the game here. We always get Kevin.
What did you learn today? You got to stop thinking with your head.
Yeah.
Trust your heart.
And this is it. Yeah, there we go. So, you know, we always give Kevin shit, and this time we're gonna take a little bit of the heat. We'll take some of the heat, Kevin. Yeah. So,
Charles, thank you for going with me and doing this together. You know, I thought it was a great adventure.
That
lovely
was awesome.
To spend time with you.
Yeah.
And we'll be back next week with a little Mission Impossible break and hopefully more Top Gun on the way.
Yeah. Oh, actually, wait.
We got to remind people. Do some plugs now, Charles.
We got to tell people. Okay, hey, everybody, you got to sign up for our Patreon. So please, please, please sign up for our Patreon at patreon.com/lightthefuse. We do weekly bonus episodes about all things Mission Impossible and other things as well. We cover other franchises and all kinds of things there. Also, you can support the show by buying a shirt or a magnet or a laptop case or anything from our Tee Public store, which is linked on our website, lightthefusepodcast.com. That's in the merch section. And you should also go over to the episode guide on our website and check out every episode that we have in our back catalog. We have talked to so many amazing people over the years.
This we have some good interviews coming up.
Yes, we have a lot in the bank right now. We've talked to a bunch of people, and very proud of what we've done with this show. It's a love letter to filmmaking, and I think if you haven't listened to old episodes, you should go back and check them all out, because there are a lot of incredible interviews we've done over the years.
Yes, and also I want to encourage people to go to our Instagram and Twitter account, LightTheFusePod.
Mm-hmm.
It was very unfortunate because they played the trailer, and then they started Top Gun 5 seconds after. So we did not get to talk about that on Twitter like we wanted to, but there will be plenty of discussion of the trailer and the movie very soon, so check that out there. And then the other thing you can do, if you could just like, subscribe, rate, and review wherever you're listening to this, just tell people about it. I think people are very into the show when they find it, so please do that. It helps us out so much.
Yes, spread the word.
And we'll be back next week. We've got a great episode I think everybody's going to enjoy. And more fun times ahead.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thanks again for listening, everyone. Before we go, another mission, should you choose to accept it, please rate, review, and subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts. And remember that you can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at LightTheFusePod, and email us questions or comments at LightTheFusePodcast@gmail.com. This message will self-destruct in 5 seconds.